Bless the Lord, brothers and sisters. I'm back yet again with another message. I thank God for this opportunity to share with you. And on my previous message, I talked about the fact that I wanted to get a little bit in depth about the spiritual weapons of our warfare. Now, brothers and sisters, we all know that we are in a spiritual war, and it's only awesome to get better equipped and educated on what you're working with, if you would, than not. So what I want to do, this may be a little bit of a lengthy message, but I'm praying that God uses me in an awesome and mighty way. And I want to start out with prayer. And I pray in the name of Jesus, if you stay to the very end, that you would see that the God who is the lover of your soul has more power than you give him credit. And he is a God of not only love, but he's a God of truth, and he's a God of justice, and he is a God of war. And brothers and sisters, you say, well, why is he a God? Well, we're fighting against a devil who's already defeated. But as you know, brothers and sisters, the devil is the hater of your soul. He's the hater of all things good, and he's the hater of all things that are godly. So if you are living a godly life, in other words, if you're not subscribing to the things of this corrupt, evil, satanic world, then you are not only a target for the enemy, but your family may be also. So what do? You sit there and you watch reality shows all day, or do you get educated, equipped, and informed as to your position and what you need to do to better equip yourself spiritually in this war? So brothers and sisters, I want to pray. I pray in the name of Jesus right now that the listener is not only educated going forward, but put their hope and their faith in things of above. Not things that are below, not things in the world, but they realize, amen, that in Christ, as they abide in you, Lord God, that they will be not only fulfilled, but they will know what true love is all about. You are not only our bodyguard, if you would, God. You are our God. You are the God of all. You are the Alpha, the Omega. I praise and I worship you, Jesus, because you are the living word, which is the truth. And I will be, amen, talking about that today. So I pray in the name of Jesus that you hear this prayer, Lord God, and I pray in the name of Jesus that in the second heaven, that this prayer will not be intercepted by any demonic forces. I pray in the name of Jesus that you give this prayer a clean pathway and a clear pathway to your throne. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we have six components that is in the armor of God. I want to talk about that, brothers and sisters, today. But I also want to let you know, brothers and sisters, that prayer is a key component, a very, very key component in putting on the whole armor of God. You have the shoes of peace. You have the breastplate of righteousness. You have the shield of faith. You have what else? The helmet of salvation, you have the, breastplate of righteousness. Just look it up and book it up. I'm going to give you some homework today. But in putting on that whole armor of God, the shield of faith, I think I said the shield of faith. But anyway, my whole thing is this, brothers and sisters, is that prayer is a key component in putting on that whole armor. Now you say to yourself, okay, I'm going to put on the whole armor. Does that mean I have to go downstairs and, you know, look through my, you know, closet and just get a hat or a belt? Brothers and sisters, what we have to realize is that the whole armor of God consists of spiritual armor. These are spiritual things. You can't fight a spiritual war in fleshly attire. I just said something there. Brothers and sisters, we are waging war against the enemy. So in having your spiritual warfare attire on, if you would. We have to also realize that we have to live holy lives also. We don't want to think that, okay, well, if we just put on, you know, this full armor of God that, you know, everyone's talking about, or the word of God speaks about, and live like the devil, you will be ineffective. In other words, the enemy will look at your armor with cracks in it, as if it had tons of cracks. And if you have cracks in your spiritual armor, those spears or darts of the enemy will get through. Now, they may not get into your, you know, in your mind, but they may get into your body. In other words, the devil may switch it up. You may feel that, you know, okay, well, I'm okay in this area, but God, you know, he freed me from this thing. But guess what? If you don't have the whole armor of God on and tight and right and prayed up and submerged in God's word and submerged in the blood of Jesus, if you don't have that as your weapon against the enemy, then the enemy will try to get through in other ways. He may try to do things that affect your health. He may try to do things that affect your finances. The enemy may do things that may affect your children. You're thinking that you have this type of child, when this type of child is living in a rebellion type of life and things of that nature. So I say this to say, brothers and sisters, that fighting this war not only affects us, but it affects the people, amen, around us. It affects our neighborhoods. It affects our communities. It affects our states and things of that nature. So the enemy does not want the armor of God or the army of God to be in battle. If only the devil can keep God's people complacent, not moving, not growing. And if only the enemy can keep God's people stupid, uneducated, unwise. Those are the tactics, brothers and sisters, that he uses. He doesn't mind that you go to church necessarily. The enemy doesn't care that you go to church. The enemy cares that what the enemy is concerned with, amen, is three things in terms of you going to church. He's concerned that if you go to the right church, the God-ordained church that God ordained, amen, that literally is having the Spirit of God indwelling in that church, that is a threat to the enemy. That's number one. Number two is having a child of God that is rightfully dividing the Word of God and saturating himself in the Word of God and living a holy life after he gets out of church, studying to show himself approved, living a holy life outside of the church building. And number three, what's number three, brothers and sisters? What do you think that is? Fearing, trusting, relying, seeking God's face through prayer and communication with God. He doesn't want that relationship between you and God to be solidified. He doesn't want that. He wants you to have a so-so relationship. He wants you to have a, you know, passe relationship with God. In other words, the devil wants your time. The devil wants your energy. The devil wants that emphasis to be with you and him. But I tell you, brothers and sisters, I tell you this. We are living in some dangerous times, brothers and sisters. And I tell you what, along with the armor of God, amen, in Ephesians, along with that, you have to realize, brothers and sisters, that there are spiritual weapons. Now, when we talk about spiritual weapons that God is working with, the battle's already won. You know, in the book of Revelation, you know at the end that we win. But I want to educate you just a little bit. I want to, you know, refresh you, if you would. Because again, I'm not a preacher or teacher or whatever. This is just a message. I'm not here to give myself any glory. This is some research that I just looked up. Amen. And I want you to know that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty. Through who? Through God. So, okay, let me tell you some of these weapons. Well, God deals with weapons like spears, spiritual spears. Now, these spears are not no tiny spears. We're talking about supernatural, huge, long, fiery spears. That if you've seen it in the spiritual realm, amen, you see what the angels are working with, it'll blow your mind. And you say, why? Well, you have an adversary, amen, an evil devil that's not playing. Now, I'm not here to give the enemy any more evil power that he already has, because he does have some power under his belt. He does. You know, I'm going to keep it real. But he's not powerful than our God. He's not powerful than the true and living mighty God. We win, brothers and sisters. Stay encouraged and know that we win. It's already won. It's just like a rinse cycle. Amen. You go do some laundry. All right. God is already, he's past the drying stage, if you would. The clothes are already put away. It's already done. We are in the preliminary stages of the cycle, but we still have a work to do. We still have cleansing. I just said something. We still have cleansing to do. I'm going to dismiss this. I apologize, brothers and sisters. And again, it's not that I'm famous or anything. It's just that somebody wants my time. But guess what? It's your time now. So we will get into those weapons. Well, God talks about sharp threshing spears and extreme burning and blasting and whirlwinds and spiritual shields and bucklers and bows and breastplates of fire. He also talks in his word about hammers, and in Romans he talks about also spiritual weapons and angelic swords and flaming swords, glittering swords and strong swords. In Isaiah 27:1, he talks about arrows. In Deuteronomy 32:41-42, brothers and sisters, we talk also in Revelation 1:16. Let's talk about that right quick. In Revelation 1:16, the word of God says, and he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. And this one is a prayer in Psalms 35:3. It talks about spears as well. It says in Psalms 35:3, draw out also the spear and stop the way against them that persecute me. Say unto my soul, I am thy salvation. So brothers and sisters, a lot of these, swords and things of that nature, we can use in the spiritual battle through prayer. In other words, if we're waging war, amen, against the spirit of darkness, we want to say things like, in the name of Jesus, I pray right now, Lord God, that you release that sword of fire against the enemy. I pray in the name of Jesus that those flaming, glittery swords and that hammer wreaks havoc against those demonic devils that's trying to come against my life, come against my family, come against my children. I pray in the name of Jesus that you send a supernatural whirlwind in a second heaven and flames of fire, a fury with your wrath that consume the whole atmosphere with your wrath against these demonic spirits. We're talking about prayer. Warfare prayer, brothers and sisters. You have to learn and know what to do. Brothers and sisters, it's one thing to, you know, pray for a car and a yacht and a big old house. Well, a lot of people are doing these days, amen? But God wants you to dig deeper. God wants you to realize that, you know, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, brothers and sisters. A lot of you are carnally minded. A lot of you feel that, you know, God is like a genie in a bottle, you know, that you could just, you know, pray a prayer of rubbing it and getting what you want. Gimme, gimme, gimme. Listen. Stop being so in love with this world. Stop being so in love with the things of this world. Huh? God is not a slot machine. I just said something there. Either. In other words, when you put some money in the plate, don't think that you're going to get, I'm just leave it there. I know y'all smart enough to know what I'm talking about in terms of the hypnosis that a lot of people are in churches, thinking that they can, you know, operate their spiritual walk like they're in a casino. I just said something again. Where they could just put some money in a basket or put some money in the machine and they're automatically going to get millions and millions in their life. Okay, I'm going to leave it there. Bless the Lord. It's 15 minutes. Brothers and sisters, we are in a battle. I had a dream a few months ago, real powerful dream. Talking about things on a technological level, things that are to come. And you heard it first. If it does happen, you know that I had this dream about it. And I'm not here to fake or fluke or anything else. You can take these messages and you can build on these messages and do your own research and draw closer to God. Or you could take these messages and, you know, click on and, you know, do whatever with it. But I have a job to do, brothers and sisters. And if you have been following me thus far, you know that I'm not playing games on this channel. I don't have time for games. Because why? Your soul's at stake. I'm here for you because I love you. And I'm here to tell you that God saved a wretch like Samantha. And now I have a work to do in this world. And that work requires God dwelling in me, me being submitted in him, and in the midst being obedient and giving God the glory, as well as being a blessing to the body of Christ. So your job is that too. And a lot of people are like, what is my purpose? And, you know, I may not be a teacher or a pastor or a preacher or this or that, or, you know, this gift. Listen, very carefully, brothers and sisters, don't underestimate God. God gives us all gifts. God gives us all talents. God gives us all vision and insight. It's up to us, brothers and sisters, to tap into what those things are. You may not be an orator. In other words, you may not be a person who speaks a lot. Well, if that's what you want to do, Word of God says, what is impossible with God? Nothing. God is a possible God. You have to talk to God. Listen, God, you know, I really want to do this. I really want to do that for your will, for your kingdom. I want to be effective. I want to be used. Well, first, you got to clean out your house spiritually and naturally. Huh? You can't be used looking like a crazy nut. You can't be used having all these demonic spirits dwelling in you. You can't be used like that, brothers and sisters. And it takes time. It takes time to get cleansed. It takes time to get cleaned up. Huh? You got old habits that you like. You like smoking, drinking, and fornicating. You like lying, you like cheating, you like beating, you like eating too much. Did I say anything? Okay. You got any spirits in you that need to be cast out? Brothers and sisters, some things come through prayer and fasting. You may have to fast after you cast. Okay. We need to cast out these demons, brothers and sisters. We have to realize that we have to have a strategic plan. People are walking around like zombies. They're walking around with so many demonic spirits that is written all over their face. Your sin is finding you out. I'm not talking about just tattoos, brothers and sisters. I'm not talking about just piercings and this and that. I'm talking about you can see the devil in them. You ever walk around a person that, you know, and I'm going somewhere with this. Just stick a while, stay a while. You ever see a person that you can not only smell the sin, but you can, oh yeah, I said it. You can smell the sin. I'm not just talking about alcohol. I'm just talking about, it's something in their spirit that radiates that they're not living right, that they're not living a holy consecrated life. You can tell. Sin has a stench. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, if you want to know what hell smells like, if you want to know what hell smells like, hear me. Just think of everybody in the world, animals included, who did a foul body movement or bowel movement, okay? Or everybody in the world, animals included, bees, bugs, they did it. They did that. And you pile it in a heap, okay? You pile it all together. And then with that, you put sickness and disease, the smell of sickness and disease. And cancer has a smell, brothers and sisters. I know it oh so well because my father passed away of cancer. And, it, you know, different diseases, venereal diseases, the things of that nature, or what, you know, whatever the case is, it radiates not a nice, you know, smell. So I say this to say, brothers and sisters, that, and I thank God I don't have any STDs or no viruses or anything like that. Don't get it twisted. I'm clean down there, if you would. If I want to be specific. Because I know these people, listen, right now I'm good. But I'm saying this, brothers and sisters, is that if you put that all together and then you want to put the smell of demons all together, then you got a sense of what hell smells like. Hell will take your breath away. The smell is so bad it takes your breath away. I want to let you know what's in store if you don't do it God's way, brothers and sisters. You ready to put the air freshener, you know, when Papa's home. Or you got a child that's whoo-wee in that bathroom a little bit too much. Or it could be you. Listen. And you mean to tell me that you don't fear God? And you mean to tell me that you're not perplexed when it comes to living right or making sure that your spiritual house is clean? I'm saying all of the spiritual warfare stuff, brothers and sisters, to let you know that hell is real. And if you're not equipped, spiritual and natural, that this world, you know, if you get so tantalized, if you would, with this world, if you want to watch reality shows, if you want to literally submerge yourself in gossip and foolishness, and you don't want to do it God's way, you want to drink, you want to party hardy, you want to have a good old time, I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, time is running out. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, God is keeping count. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, if you don't have a made up mind today, if you're living like the devil and you don't have a made up mind today to serve God, God will sift you out. God will sift you out. So I want to make it very, 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 very clear. If you on God's side, in other words, if you team Jesus, some people say team Jesus, but if you're on right standing with God, if you want to be on God's team, you better know that you're not going to be sitting on a bench letting other people fight, letting other people war in the spirit, letting other people learn spiritually, let other people soldier for the Lord, and you just sitting down eating candy, listening to videos all day. And I'm not saying not to listen to my videos, because I listen to other people's videos too. Absolutely. But when it comes to the fact of the word of God, you're not worded up, you're not rightly dividing the truth, you're not reading, you're not studying, and I will, of course, you know me, I will leave scriptures as well. But when I say stuff like, he shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shall thy trust, his truth shall be thy shield and buckler. When I say stuff like that, and you look, you know, like, oh, she's just reading a word, and, you know, it's just a word, you know, I'm ready to go, I'm ready to go, I'm ready to go, I'm ready to do something, you know. If you get bored with the word, there's something wrong with you. If you don't want to pray, there's something wrong with you. If you don't want to seek God's face, there's something wrong with you. If you don't want to live a holy, consecrated life, there's something very, very wrong with you. But if you love the Lord, if you realize that the Word of God not only gives you spiritual nourishment, that it's the only truth that you can stand on in this wicked world. You know, I heard a story. I'm about to close soon. It's almost 25 minutes. It's a powerful video. I hope you enjoyed. I really have enjoyed this time with you, brothers and sisters. But I will tell you about my dream too, real quick. But, you know, I heard about a story that there was a fire, you know, and it's just, you could look it up on YouTube. I'm not lying about this, but there was a fire in somebody's house, or I think this happened maybe two places or two different instances with two different people, and somebody's house caught on fire. And the Bible, hallelujah to the Lamb of God, hear me, the Bible was not burned. Maybe the front got a little, you know, messed up, but the actual word, hallelujah to the Lamb. Did I do something to your spirit just now? Did you catch that? The Bible, everything in the house was burnt crispy, crispy, crispy. But the Bible, each page was white as snow. Each page was not bothered. Look it up. Look, go online. Listen, what does that say about the Word of God? What does that say about the true and living God? I'll let you figure that out, brothers and sisters. God's Word is true. I had a dream. Maybe, I don't know if I just said that, but technologically, I'm talking about now. I had a dream about 6 months ago or something like that. And it's been 25 minutes. I'm not sure if I said this or not. But anyway, technology is changing and at an astronomical rate. And I'm telling you the truth. If you're not aware of what the enemy is all about, these physicists are really cooking up something foul, evil. See, brothers and sisters, the enemy is trying to come up with a concept that anything God says or does, the enemy tries to carbon copy and pervert and do it evilly or in an evil way. He cannot create anything. God created him. He is created. But he will try to twist and entangle and manipulate. That's his MO, and lie. He's a thief. He steals, kills, and destroys things. So anything holy, anything godly, amen, he wants to distort. Look at marriage. Marriage is a holy thing. It started in the Garden of Eden. It started in the beginning, the union of marriage. And look at marriage now. I'm not talking about gay marriage. I don't consider that marriage. I'm just talking about between a husband and wife. The institution of marriage has become... There's so many people that are divorced, even in the body of Christ. And, you know, you wonder where the prayer was. You wonder where the devotion is. And you wonder where God was in the midst. And I'll tell you this, brothers and sisters. And I don't want to get off topic because there's so much to cover. And it's 27 minutes. But anyway, I had a dream, and it was like I was at a... Not a fair, but it was like I was at a, you know how they have some seminars and they have booths and people sell stuff, people, it's trade shows. It was like a trade show atmosphere. And in this particular dream, it was a lady there and was a guy there, and it was pretty much showing people some technological stuff, which was just happened to be satanic. And if you see this to come, just know that you heard it here. But just like the Transformers movie, I've seen it on a Transformers movie, but I also seen it in my dream. It was like they had like liquid metal and it was morphing into things. And this guy had it. It was like literally like if you wanted anything, anything you asked it basically to do, it would morph into. So in other words, you ever seen a Janet Jackson back in the days when we all was all in the world and you saw how that, or Terminator, I think it was, when the guy turned into liquid metal, that's the substance of what he was holding in his hand. And it had to be the size of a, it was very small, you know, but it morphed into whatever you wanted it to do. In other words, they had it, and if you wanted a cheeseburger, it morphed into a cheeseburger. But it was liquid metal originally. If you wanted a bed, if you wanted a pillow, whatever the case is, a shoe, it would morph into that. And, you know, as, you know, people were mesmerized. But I say this to say, brothers and sisters, they have holograms now. They have cyborgs. They have cloning. They have so much that's coming in a pipeline. And in the midst of the end of that dream, there was like a bucket. And I looked inside of that bucket, and it had that liquid metal type of stuff in the bucket. And guess what happened, brothers and sisters? Hear me. True dream. I don't have time for games. I saw the devil's face, brothers and sisters, and he was smiling and laughing with a sinister laugh at me. And I say this, we talk about, that, you know, about CERN and, you know, the gates of hell they talk about that are opening, whereas physicists basically have tried to, you know, use things to basically on a cellular level, or not even a cellular level, on a atomic level or on a molecular level. I'm not a physicist, but basically they're trying to open up a dimension, a demonic dimension, so that the demons of hell, or, you know, Satan himself, could get through our atmosphere. But brothers and sisters, if you know anything about spiritual warfare, okay, you know that the devil is in the air. He's the prince of the air. He's already here. Okay, demons are already here as well. But the bottom line is this. If the devil can only manipulate people where people are looking human, but yet they are cyborgs, or people are looking human, but they could somehow last or live longer or never die. This is the type of sick, satanic philosophy that a lot of these physicists are going by. Because 9 times out of 10, hear me, a lot of these physicists, a lot of these doctors that are cooking up some demonic dark world, of course they're getting their information from the devil and demons, the demon technology, but a lot of them are not saved, brothers and sisters. They're not saved. They don't want Jesus. They don't want Jesus. So if you're living in a world, brothers and sisters, where a lot of stuff is to come, and you're not guarded up, and you're not worded up, and you're not rightfully dividing what's real and what's not, and you knowing that the Word of God talks about in Antichrist that even the very elect, in other words, even the children of God, are going to be tricked, bamboozled, and, you know, loving what they see, or mesmerized, if you would. We got to start now, brothers and sisters. We got to start now. We got to start praying more. We got to start fasting more. We got to start getting in our word more. We got to start educating ourselves. It can't be a Sunday after Sunday type of relationship. Brothers and sisters, God is calling us higher. Hear me. When I told y'all I saw it, and this is it, I promise you. I promise you, this is it. I just get so deep, and I get so... I want to try to get everything in, and I want to close with this, brothers and sisters. Hear me. I told y'all I heard the voice of God. I'm not here to lie. I'm not a fluke. I heard the voice of God. And when they talk about God's voice sounds like thunder and lightning and power, it doesn't give God enough credit. God's voice is a sound that you would never forget, and I would never forget God's voice. And you know what he said in the dream? God said, he was angry with this world, and he said, this world is consumed with TV and not me. I just said something that God said to me. You need to check your life. Are you too consumed with this idol that you put in your back pocket? Are you watching a little bit too much reality shows? Are you living your life through a reality celebrity? I just said something. Instead of spending time with things from above, are you consumed with the troubles of this world from below? And I'm about to blow your mind, and I'm going to close. Some people are so intrigued with things from the underworld to the point where Satan is using them there. They got a lot of demonic stuff that they talk about exclusively And one thing about spiritual warfare, you got to get both sides, brothers and sisters. Yes, demons are real. Yes, the devil's real, but we win. We have weapons, and the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. I hope, brothers and sisters, that this message is not only powerful, but I want to tell you something also, is that I made a message before this, and it wasn't right. It was 35 minutes or 30 minutes worth of a message, and it wasn't right. So God said, do it over. And this is not the first time that I've ever done a message and it didn't come out right, or the plug gets pulled or something like that. This is a spiritual message. I hope you heard God in this message, because I did. I hope you're blessed. And I hope you realize that you are a soldier. You are a soldier in the army of the Lord. And you need to be equipped. You need to get on post. And you need to know that you will win. As long as you are in Christ. Bless the living God. Till next time. Out.